नमस्कार। टुडे वी शैल हैव द सेकंड सेशन ऑन द ताजमहल, द हिस्ट्री ऑफ द ताजमहल। एंड इन दिस सेशन वी विल मेक अ बिगिनिंग ऑफ डिस्कशन ऑन आर्किटेक्चर एंड सिंबोलिज्म। द फर्स्ट पार्ट वॉज ऑन द हिस्टोरिकल डॉक्यूमेंट्स एंड ट्रैवलॉग्स। The travelogues are written by some of the European travelers who came to India at that time in the 17th century, and the historical court documents, the documents pertaining to, belonging to Shah Jahan's court. There is one official history named as Badshah Nama, written by Mullah Abdul Hamid Lahori, which has two volumes. Both the volumes have some mention, some reference to the Taj Mahal. In the first of them, it talks about the shifting of Mumtaz's body from Burhanpur to Agra and burying it inside the Taj Mahal. And in the second volume, the reference is about the structure, the expenses incurred. So both the volumes refer to the Taj Mahal in some way or the other. In addition, there are four farmans, which means the court orders of Shah Jahan, which refer to the acquisition of marble after he began his work on the marble edifice. But from the court documents and the contemporary travelogues, the following conclusions emerge. I have listed five of them. I'll just read them. Following the death of Mumtaz Mahal, Shah Jahan acquired Raja Man Singh's palace for the burial of the queen. This reference is there in Badshah Nama volume 1, and it is there in one of his farmans. I call it the farman number 3. It is dated December 28, 1633. Both of them refer to the acquisition of an existing palace for the burial of the queen. The court paper refers to four mansions given as compensation to Raja Jai Singh in exchange of the building which has been acquired by Shah Jahan. Four mansions. It is not an ordinary transaction. Because of the entire complex has been acquired, four mansions, existing mansions were given as compensation. And that farman is dated 1633 December. That is roughly 2 full years after the death of Mumtaz Mahal. 2 full years after the death, 2 full years after the body was shifted to Agra. The Taj was an ancient building is borne out by the extensive repair carried out by Aurangzeb in 1652. It is very detailed. It lists not only damage to the main dome, but also the minor domes, and also to the mosque and the Jawab. And he has also describes what is the repair work that he carried out, how the concrete was relaid, etc., etc. But he also mentions that the architects were unable to suggest a mode of repairs. They were uncertain a mode of repair for the main dome. That was in 1652. And Shah Jahan spent about 40 to 50 lakhs of rupees upon this building. Badshah Nama volume 1 says 40 lakhs. Chihal lakh rupaya. Volume 2 says 50 lakhs. This is a statement in volume 2. The entire complex is known as Mumtazabad. The cost of all the buildings described were completed in about 12 years under the supervision of Makramat Khan and Abdul Karim is 50 lakhs of rupees. The calligraphy was the most important work under Shah Jahan. is evident from the inscription inside the Senate of Chamber, which bears the signature of Amanat Khan Shirazi. It is written by this insignificant being Amanat Khan Shirazi in the 12th year of the emperor's reign. That is supposed to be 1639 AD. There is no mention of the architect who conceived, who designed, and who supervised the construction of the Taj Mahal, either in the inscriptions of the Badshahnama or inscriptions on the walls of the Taj Mahal or in the court papers. There is one paper, a Persian manuscript, which was referred to by E.B. Havel, which lists the name of Ustad Isa as one of the chief architects, it lists him as the chief architect, but his salary was comparable. In fact, it is the same as that the salary of this Amanat Khan Shirazi, who is a chief calligrapher, and also that of the chief mason. So it is very unlikely that the person who conceived Taj Mahal is treated on par with a chief mason. And added to that, the name of the chief architect doesn't appear in the Badshahnama, whereas the name of Bebadal Khan, under whose supervision a gold railing was installed around the tomb of Mumtaz at the expense of 6 lakhs, has been referred to. But chief architect is not referred to. The whole work under Shah Jahan lasted about 12 years. This is evident from the fact that the inscription says 1639 AD, and it also is evident from Manrik's observation that the work was nearly complete by the time he visited Agra in 1640-41 winter. So this is what we can conclude generally from a coherent thesis that emerges from the discussion on the court papers and the travelogues. Today we shall look at the architecture. We'll make a beginning. There are two sections on architecture. The first section will deal with the minarets. Because if you look at the, in spite of all these evidences presented in terms of court papers or travelogues, by and large, this thesis is not accepted. By and large, the people the world over, and the historians in particular, feel that it is Shah Jahan who built the Taj Mahal. There is no evidence, but then there is a feeling that it is he who has built. This feeling emerges from the fact that the architecture of Taj Mahal is believed all over the world that it is Mughal architecture. In fact, it is considered to be the epitome of Mughal architecture. And it is also believed that the rudiments of this architectural style were developed in Samarkand, the original seat of the Mughals. Samarkand is somewhere in Russia, from where the Mughals invaded India. And the original founder of this dynasty was Taimurlung. Taimurlung built the city of Samarkand, his capital city. And the architecture of Taimurlung somewhat appears to be similar to that of the Taj Mahal, and people draw parallel to Akbar's architecture. So the Mughal architecture is derived from Samarkand. That is the logic. In support of this, they cite three major things. One is the dome. Generally, dome is believed to be Islamic architecture. Maybe some other society has borrowed it, but then it must have been originally Islamic architecture. This is how the belief is. Another is minaret. Minaret is considered to be more Islamic than even the dome, because the minaret has a reason to be there in Islamic architecture. See, in earlier days, earlier days of Islam, I'm talking about, the call of the prayer, that is the azan, this call is given 5 times a day. A believer is supposed to pray 5 times every day. So this call, this reminder, is given from the mosque, from an elevated position in the mosque, and for that purpose, a minaret emerged. And usually it is a single minaret and it is taller than the dome from where the call of the prayer is shouted. Therefore, it is believed, because of this functional utility, it is believed that it is part of Islamic architecture, and Taj Mahal shows minarets, and therefore it must be Islamic architecture only. And then there is a third point, which is known as the single pointed arch. See, the entrance of the building will have an arch, and that arch can have one point or many points. And generally it is believed that the single pointed arch, like the tip of a leaf, you know, it's pointing upwards. So the arch is shaped in a particular way. It is called single pointed arch. This is also believed to be Islamic in origin. The single point is supposed to signify one God. That is the argument given. So it must have been from that. So we will examine all these three, but today we shall focus attention on the minarets. In this section, we will look at the minarets as well as the symbolism. First the symbolism, and then we'll go to minarets. This is a building where Mumtaz Mahal died at Burhanpur. It still exists. Burhanpur is in Madhya Pradesh, where Shah Jahan was campaigning, and he resided in this Mahal, and that is where Mumtaz Mahal died. This is where the tomb was built in Burhanpur for Mumtaz Mahal. I just cited this only for the sake of completeness. See, this arch is not a single pointed arch. You'll see there are many ornamentations here. If you take only the bare tip of this, that is single pointed. Leave the ornamentation, but see only the tip here. That is called a single point arch. Let me look at the architectural aspects of this building. So this is a riverside view of the Taj Mahal. And you see it is a huge complex. The marble platform is about 328 feet each side. It is a square, and each side is 328 feet. And the height of this marble platform is about 21 feet or so. Not very, very short. It is quite a bit. And you need to compare that, both the size of this platform and the height of this platform, with what Parshanama volume 2 says. It is nowhere near this dimension. And below this marble platform is the red stone platform. It is called the terrace, the red stone terrace. It is quite wide. On either end of this, one end is the mosque on the right, and on the left it is the Jawab or the community hall. If you include both of them, and from end to end, it's about 1,000 feet. And just below this marble platform, there are two floors. There are two floors. I have shown the plinth here. This is upon the riverbed. And there are two floors, and in the upper of these two floors, there are rooms. I'll show you the photograph of those rooms. And there is a long corridor which you enter from one end of this marble platform and you can also enter it from the other end. So there is a long corridor running about 322 feet. Entrance is from the terrace. It's a staircase going downwards, opening to a long corridor. And on either side of the corridor, there are rooms. On the river side, there are 22 rooms, the size of which are 11 feet by 10, 11 feet by 10 feet, and 11 feet by 20 feet. Totally about 22 rooms are there. Totally 22 rooms. Look at the marble platform, which is quite tall. The individual being may be about 5 feet, 6 inches, or 8 inches, or 10 inches. But then the platform is about 21 feet. Whereas the minaret that we are going to discuss is 18.8 feet diameter at the bottom. And it rises to a height of 143.4 feet totally from the basement to the pinnacle. All the four of them are symmetrical, identical in construction. This is the riverside view. This photograph is taken from the terrace, and you would see there are two floors below. I'll presently show one more photograph where you will see them clearly. There are two floors below, and it is here. Okay, one floor is here, and another floor is here. Both of them have rooms, but I do not know how many rooms are there in the basement. But certainly there was one room which had a door, and the door was, the piece of that door, dilapidated door, was taken by Marvin Mills, and he subjected it to carbon dating. I have shown you in an earlier presentation. And in this floor, shall I call it the second floor? In the second floor, see, this red stone slab is actually covering the window of a room. The room is behind, which is 10 feet by 11 feet or 10 feet by 20 feet. Sorry, 11 feet by 20 feet. Rooms are there. And the windows are covered by red. It is covered by brick and mortar. Then from the outside, it is a red sandstone which is being plastered. So if you take the view from the terrace, you will see there is a small, this thing here, construction here, as well as a similar construction there, which is actually opening to a corridor. This is a corridor. So this is the opening, a staircase. Right now, these corridors are actually closed, and it is not allowed for public view. But these photographs were earlier to that. This underground corridor was detected in 1900. In fact, underground chambers, these 22 rooms which I mentioned, were detected in 1900 AD. Obviously, it was detected under the British period, because the British were already in possession of this Taj complex by 1810 or so. They were completely, by that time, the Mughals' rule had actually ended in the North India. Bahadur Shah Zafar, his rule did not extend beyond the Red Fort in 1857. So the building had come under the British around 1810 also. So the underground chambers were detected only in 1900. So obviously the British found them out, they revealed it to the world. So obviously they did not seal the floors. Obviously the question arises, who sealed them? The answer is obvious. I think the earlier rulers must have sealed, and that must have been sealed by Shah Jahan, because the rooms are not really useful in a tomb. This is the corridor. This is the inside of a room. You will notice that the room was plastered. You will also notice on the left that there is a bricks and mortar is used to close an opening here. Rooms were probably well kept during the period when it was being used for some purpose. You will notice that the window frames are still intact. These are wooden frames. This is what I would say, that these things can be used for carbon dating very well, but closed with brick and mortar here. You can notice the size, which may be about 6.5-7 feet tall. Another view of this. The question again and again comes is, who sealed them and why? These are, sealing is not very proper. It is a patchwork which did not last very long. So in 1896, an author, a historian by name Syed Muhammad Latif wrote about the Taj Mahal, saying that the building was originally a palace of Raja Man Singh. Please note the year, 1896, he was still saying it was originally the palace of Raja Man Singh, but now it was the property of his grandson Raja Jai Singh, that is at the time of acquisition by Shah Jahan. His Majesty gave the Raja a lofty edifice from the Khalsa estate in exchange of this building. Factually, this is not fully correct, because the Farman says he gave four edifices, four Havelis. And the spot was used for the mausoleum of the deceased empress. Now, this word spot can be interpreted in many ways. It is a spot inside the building, or it is a spot chosen for the burial of the king. It can be seen as without referring to the building also. So some people refer to the spot, okay, he has said spot. So it is not a building type of a thing, but the earlier statement is very clear. If you can call it a spot as a place only if you ignore the fact that it was an acquired building. Now in 1903, another author by name Mohiuddin Ahmad says the 22 basement rooms were detected in 1900. In 1903, Mohiuddin Ahmad discusses them in his book, The History of the Taj. And he says, the real object of building them remains a mystery. If those who say that Shah Jahan actually excavated and built the building from the foundation onwards should explain this. Why is that he would build so many rooms there, elaborate structures there, and then seal them? If you accept that it was built for a different purpose, maybe Raja Man Singh Palace or something else earlier, then of course you may have an explanation that the rooms were there for this, for certain purpose, but we did not find a suitable purpose in a tomb. So they were sealed. That is the only explanation one can give in the light of the fact that Shah Jahan himself states that it is Raja Man Singh's palace. In addition to these underground chambers, you should also look at the Nakkar Khanas, either Nakkar Khana or Nagar Khana. The meaning of Nagar Khana in a colloquial terms is drum houses. You have seen those drum houses, they are elaborate structures with single dome. This is the drum house. There are two of them, perfectly symmetrical on either side of the Taj complex. Two floor building, single dome building. They are important buildings. Out of the six structures inside the Taj complex, two of them are these. They are called Nakkar Khanas or Nagar Khanas. If you ask the locals there, they will say, Kya rakhte the bhai? They will say, Nagada rakhte the. Nagada means drum. It is a really a curious matter, because in Nagar Khana, in a tomb, what is the purpose of that? Tomb is not a place for festivity. In a tomb, what they perform is an urus. Urus is once a year they perform that. And the rest of the year, there are no festivities inside the tomb. Therefore, what are the drums meant for? The secondly, see, the drums are taboo in Islam, really. Music is taboo in Islam. Drums are taboo in Islam. And in India, we have seen riots happening because drum beats going in front of mosques, etc. Inside the Taj complex, there is a mosque. And why would somebody build structures to keep a drum as if they are being used every day in the presence of a mosque? Then there is another term that is being used, which looked very strange to me. There is a place called Gaushala. I have shown you the Gaushala in the outer courtyard to the southeast of the outer courtyard. There is a place called Gaushala. See, this name Gaushala is a Sanskrit word. It is not a Persian word. And of course, the one would not keep cows inside the mosque. That is one thing. Whereas a Gaushala can be a very natural and normal place in a palace or in a temple. And it is in Sanskrit origin. Let us look at a little more of symbolism. See, this is the main gateway. Huge structure, you see the people there. It is a two-story building, and on the top of which, see, this is the single-pointed arch. You see, it's single point. Everywhere in Taj Mahal, you see single-pointed arch. This is considered to be Islamic because of the single pointing. However, on top of the single-pointed arch, you see mini domes there, a row of mini domes there. And if you count them, they are 11 in number. 11 in number. So the story is made out that, okay, Shah Jahan took 22 years to build this building. And there are 11 mini domes here and 11 mini domes, totally 22. It signifies 22 years for the building. But we have seen that in Parshanama itself, it says it took only 12 years. So this story, this legend doesn't hold water. Secondly, 11 has no significance in Islam. If anything, Islam has a significance only for one. You talk about single point and arc because there is one God, they say. If there is only one God, then you look at the mosque, it is a triple domed structure. Trinity has no business in Islam. Trinity has some respect, some value in Christianity, but not in Islam. Islam, it means one and only one. They are emphatic on that. And 11 does not have any specific meaning in Islam. And P and O refers to this 11 as symbolic of Kalashas. There is a reference for the dome as Kalasha in the Shilpa Shastras. Havel also refers to it. I'll show you the quotations from Havel. Quotation from Shilpa Shastra quoted by Havel. Yeah. If it represents Kalashas, then 11 Kalashas, he says that it is Ekadasha Rudra. It's symbolic of Shiva. Yeah, you can count them here. There are 11 of them and 11 of them there. Let's go further. Now, this is in the main gateway only. On the side, there are you know, pictures of this kind, the carvings and artwork of this kind. This is called paneer dani. This is called ilaichi, ilaichi plate, where they offer ilaichi and paneer for the guests. Therefore, they are Rajput symbolism according to P. N. Oak. This is a kind of torana which, you know, if you stretch your imagination, you'll find that this is very similar to the sound of an elephant. P. N. Oak calls it as Ganesha Torana. He says that it is elephant. Elephant is a very natural and normal symbol among the Rajput architecture, in the Rajput architecture. He calls it Ganesha Torana. I would refrain from commenting further because I do not know whether you can make it as a Ganesha Torana, you can make it as an ordinary artwork. But if it is Ganesha Torana, it is not Islamic for sure, because any animate construct is taboo in Islam. It is forbidden. So if you look at the Islamic artwork on the walls and other things, you will see only curves and circles and that kind of things, which do not indicate, which do not represent any animals, do not even closely resemble any animals or human life. And this is in the main building. It is near the entrance. As you enter, you would see artwork on the walls. Can you call them Islamic? You can call them Islamic because it really does not show anything specific. However, on close observation, you would see that these are bell flowers. Bell flowers are special to Shiva. So Oak calls them as bell flowers, and bell flowers are specific to Shiva as a deity. And then the artwork, the flowering has a particular shape, which is very exquisite. If you see this, you will notice that there is an Om symbol here. It is artistic in nature. It is not a perfect Om, you would say, yes, but it is bell flower is obvious. This is at the height of about your waist, some 4 feet on the wall. Not all this, I'm sure that the artwork has been changed by Shah Jahan, because he has changed the inscriptions on the wall. He has pasted calligraphical work, inlay work, etc., the work which he has done. But some of them he might have left untouched also, if they are harmless, if they are not against his religion. For example, these are just flowers. You can make sense out of it. You may not make any sense out of it. It can be called Indian architecture. It can be called Islamic architecture. So they must have left it to remain like that. But there are places where you expect artworks of this kind in the wall, but it is completely blank. Now this is the main dome, and it is 59 feet wide in diameter inside, and about 81 feet tall from the plinth of the dome to the pinnacle, 81 feet tall, 59 feet diameter. And if you look at the pinnacle, which is a copper pinnacle right now, which measures about 32.5 feet from here to here. And you also notice the inverted lotus symbol. Not part of Islamic architecture until the Taj Mahal, I would say. It was not. I'll show you examples of that. Yeah. With an exception of Babur's mosque, that is Babari Masjid. It has inverted lotus symbol. But that could have been very well have been an earlier dome which was left there. Yeah, the Balbas dome is known as, the Taj dome is known as the Balbas dome because it resembles an onion bulb. It is a curve and other things are very special. It is unlike all other domes in the whole world. Later attempts were there to build similar things, and partially succeeded in doing that, but Thar dome is considered to be unique in its curvature. It sits on a lotus flower, an open lotus flower, whereas an inverted lotus on top of the building. And there is a pinnacle which measures quite a height, about 32.5 feet is what the present pinnacle is. This may not be the original pinnacle, but it may still resemble the shape of the original pinnacle. If you accept that it is an original pinnacle, you see the on the top of that, there is a curve here. It has a three-tongued pinnacle. Finial is three-tongued. And a closer look at that is here. Havel calls this as a kalasha. This is a kalasha. This is coconut. This is mango leaves. But then people point out that there is a moon here. Moon is an Islamic symbol. Moon is an Islamic symbol, but then it is not a symbol of this kind. You see, the moon symbol is curved. It is called Eid Ka Chand. It is Eid Ka Chand, and typically mosque having that is having a curved, tilted moon. This is the mosque in Oman. You see, it's a tilted moon. That is the pinnacle. And you also notice a minaret here, which is an Islamic mosque, and the minaret is taller than the main dome. And there is only one minaret. Taj has four of them. It is typical of Hindu architecture, where, say, a temple will indicate the deity within. The finial of the temple will indicate which is the deity who is being worshipped. This is from Gujarat, Somnath temple. And you see on the top, there is a Trishul. So, symbol of Shiva. If it is a Kartikeya, it will be a Bhala. And you will also see peacocks in the Kartikeya temple. Whereas in the case of Shiva, there will be Nandi, etc. It's the same temple in Gujarat at Somnath. Coming back to the finial, there's a close-up view, and it is a copper finial. And there is something inscribed here. I was told that it means Allah. Allah. This inscription is not ancient. This inscription is not ancient. It is, so the history is, I'll come to the history point. See, this is the inlay work of the finial in upon the terrace in front of the Jawab. Not in front of the mosque, but in front of the Jawab. There is one inlay work. In front of the mosque, this doesn't exist. And the length of this, I think this is the original shape of the finial, because it is in the inlay work. I mean, nobody disturbed it. The size of the inlay work is 30.5 feet, 30 feet 6 inches, whereas the size of the copper pinnacle upon the building is 32.5 feet. Could be that the original finial was of this size, but it was changed sometime in 1820s, I think. On the top of the central dome of the Taj Mahal, there is a copper pinnacle which measures 32.5 and half inches. On the eastern redstone courtyard, in front of the community hall, there is a figure of the pinnacle inlaid in black marble, which measures a length of 30 feet 6 inches. The Shahjahan Nama of Muhammad Salah Kumbho mentions that the pinnacle was of pure gold. But by 1873-74, it was already of copper. And when it was taken down for regilding, the words Joseph Taylor were found engraved upon the copper. What was replaced contains the word Allah, but what was there in 1873 contained the name of Joseph Taylor. Captain Taylor was a British official who carried out the repairs to the Taj Mahal in 1810. It is reasonable to assume that the original gold pinnacle was replaced by either Joseph Taylor himself or his predecessors. This may explain the discrepancy in the length of the pinnacle and corresponding inlay work upon the courtyard. Presently, it is copper. It contains the word Allah. This is a sealed chamber, and you would notice the patchwork here. Generally, Taj Mahal is free from the patchwork, you would say. But then if it is somebody touches it again, there may be this kind of complaints. This is the Senate of in the third floor of the building. If I call the chambers and other things a second floor, the third floor is the red stone terrace. This is at that level, but it is one floor below the marble platform. The central one is Mumtaz Mahal's tomb, and the other one is Shah Jahan's tomb. This work, artwork around the tomb, is called a screen, which is said to be of a Persian architecture, etc., which may be, which may not be. It requires a deeper study for concluding it that way. So this cenotaph was complete by June 1st, 1632. Remember, January 8th, Mumtaz's body was brought inside. It brought to Agra, buried outside, and then finally buried inside 6 months later. It is said next year. So it must be 6 months later, because June 1st, 1632, the cenotaph was built. And this is on the inside of the dome, the upper part of the dome, where you would see, of course, normally you would say this is a symbol of sun. And sun symbol is very common among the Rajput architecture. Now, when you show all these symbolisms, our historians do accept that they are Hindu symbolisms. Many places you see them, yes, we see them. But then they justify it saying, see, these symbolisms are contributions by the Hindu craftsmen working under Shah Jahan. And Shah Jahan was very tolerant and allowed them to display their talent in Mumtaz Mahal's tomb. So it only shows that he is tolerant and he is a synthesizing genius. This is the kind of certificate Shah Jahan is given because he accommodated Hindu symbolism. However, Shah Jahan was very scrupulous on religious matters, as the Badshah Nama says. And also there is an example in the Badshah Nama itself, the kind of religious tolerance he displayed towards other religions, especially Hinduism. This is a quote from the Badshah Nama. It says, "It has been brought to the notice of His Majesty that during the late reign, many idol temples had begun but remained unfinished at Benares, the great stronghold of infidelity. The infidels were now desirous of completing them. His Majesty, the defender of the faith, gave orders that at Benares and throughout all his dominions, at every place, all temples should be cast down. It was now reported from the province of Allahabad that 76 temples had been destroyed in the district of Benares alone. this is his tolerance. We know that Aurangzeb was intolerant. He destroyed many temples. But Shah Jahan was relatively less intolerant, but he was no lover of Hinduism and no lover of Hindu symbols, which indicate the infidel religion. Okay, let us look at minarets in Islamic architecture. So Taj has four minarets. Please notice that all these four minarets are shorter than the main dome and they are symmetrically placed and they do not have a functional utility. There is no place for giving a shout from the minaret. They are not meant for the purpose of giving azans. So from the Islamic source, if you say that that connection is severe. Secondly, you will find that the main building has four minarets, but the mosque doesn't have any minaret. If at all the minaret is part of Islamic architecture, it must have been there in the mosque also. Of course, it is not required to be in the tomb, but then it is more relevant, more pertinent to be in the mosque. But whereas a mosque in the Taj complex is simply a three-domed building without a minaret. How do you say that it is Islamic architecture? Now, you are in for surprise. In fact, the minarets were not part of Islamic architecture in India for the first 400 years. The very first attempt of building a minaret was done in 1192 when Mohammad Ghori defeated Prithviraj Chauhan. And then he went on a rampage. He went to Ajmer. Ajmer, he destroyed something like 30 temples and built a mosque there. It is known as Athai Din Ki Jhopda. Jhopda means building. Usually a dilapidated building is called Jhopda. But Athai Din Ki, Athai means two and a half days, he built a mosque there. And outside that mosque, he built minarets. He attempted building minaret, but those minarets fell off because of faulty construction. This is at Ajmer. After it fell off, the Pathan architecture, what we call as Pathan architecture, belongs to the time of 1192 to 1526. 1526, Babur came. Before that, there were four dynasties who ruled from Delhi. They are known as Pathans. So it's called Pathan architecture for that period. So that is about how many years? Some 333 years. That was the Pathan architecture. And during the Pathan architecture period, during the Pathan period, the first attempt was at Ajmer. And after that, they did not build any minarets. This is a quotation from Ferguson. James Ferguson was the pioneer who did the classification of Indian architecture around 1865. He wrote three books, Indian and Eastern Architectures. It was published in 1865, 76, etc. But this is what Ferguson says. Ferguson's classification holds on even today. Most people accept it as a bona fide classification. He says, in the medieval architecture of Persia and Baghdad, the minaret was an important feature. But in India, minarets are not part of the Pathan architecture for three centuries, with the sole exception of the first mosque built by the invading Afghans at Ajmer. At Ajmer, The Afghans attempted to build a mosque with minarets which fell off due to faulty construction, and the subsequent Pathan architecture for the next three centuries did not contain minarets. This is the Adhai Din Ki Jhopra. Din Ka Jhopra. This is called a screen in front of the mosque. Mosque is behind. Mosque is behind. I'll show you the mosque. This is the mosque. You would see that all these buildings are taken from the temples which he destroyed. There are carvings which are un-Islamic for sure. Some people call it as Hindu style of pillars. It is not Hindu style of pillars. It is Hindu pillars, Hindu temple pillars, which were used to build a mosque. And it is said that he built it in 2.5 days, 60 hours, but actually not complete. It has taken several years to complete by Qutbuddin Aibak later. But this is the screen in front of that building, and you would see two minarets built here, the two of them. But you also see that they are broken and they have fallen off. People say that it is because of the faulty construction, because these minarets do not have a base. They have no foundation. They are built on the shoulder of the screen. And you would certainly see the single pointed arch here, which is said to be Islamic. So the minarets fell off due to faulty construction. Originally, it was a Sanskrit college, is what Wikipedia says, built by Vigraharaja of Chauhan dynasty. Chauhan dynasty is the same dynasty as Prithviraj Chauhan. So it was built about 50 years earlier to that, and this was destroyed. And there are around 20, 30 other temples were destroyed. And then the Adhai Din Ka Jhopra was built. So Ferguson's words, in the first rude attempt at Ajmer, the minarets fell off due to faulty construction. I'm quoting Ferguson now. Minarets, so far as I know, were not attached to mosques during the so-called Pathan period. The call to prayer was made from the roof. And except the first rude attempt at Ajmer, I do not know an instance of a minaret built solely for such a purpose. Though they were, as we know, universal in Egypt and elsewhere long before this time, and were considered nearly indispensable in the buildings of Mughals very shortly afterwards. I have a comment to make on this word indispensable. He says this word indispensable because he considers Taj Mahal as the epitome of Mughal architecture. But the pre-Taj architecture of the Mughals also did not contain minarets. This is typical Islamic architecture. We have seen this image earlier. This is from Oman. This may not be an ancient mosque. It may be a recent mosque, but then it is Islamic architecture. This is also not an ancient architecture, but this is, I have taken it from, I think this is in Egypt, or Egypt, yeah, a mosque in Egypt. But you see the minaret rising well above the dome, and it is a single minaret, and the functional roots of this minaret is seen here. It is a place where somebody can stand and give a call. That is Islamic minaret. I say that this is not ancient. This mosque is actually quite recent. It is the 20th century mosque, 1929 to 45, and it uses several domes here. In fact, this is what is called the Pancharatna style. This is very similar to the Taj. There are four minor domes surrounding a major dome. So I don't think this five dome is an Islamic architecture. Nowhere else you'll see five domes except in this major building in Egypt. And it is recent. It is only one century old, less than one century old. This is This is in Baghdad. This also may not be a very ancient mosque, but you see the symbol of Islam here, a minaret which is very tall, taller than the main dome. And it is a single minaret. Yeah. This is Babur's architecture. Babur's architecture. This is the Babri Masjid. But then no minarets. This is the beginning of the Mughal architecture. In fact, in the Mughal dynasty, there were four builders. One was Babur, that is Mir Baqi. His commander Mir Baqi is supposed to have built this. Humayun did not build many buildings. It was Akbar who built. Jahangir did not build many. It was Shahjahan who built. Then Aurangzeb built. And after that, there were no significant contribution to architecture by the rulers of Mughal dynasty. There were 13 of them until 1857. But this is the first Mughal architecture, if you can call it. But you see that there is inverted lotus flower on all the three domes. First of all, three dome is not Islamic. Triple dome is not Islamic. Second thing is that a lotus is not a symbol of Arabian architecture where there is no water. My guess is that these domes were belonging to an earlier culture, earlier construction, which were retained by the subsequent occupant. If you ask me, I would say these domes are very nicely built, very fine finish. The curvature and other things are very fine. This is not the Taj dome, but then it's a dome. It's a dome. And Akbar's architecture are related to, are connected to Humayun's tomb, naturally. It was Akbar who has built Humayun's tomb. Then Sikandara is his own tomb. Akbar built his own tomb in Agra. Humayun's tomb is in Delhi. Akbar's own tomb, which is called Sikandara, is in Agra. And then Fatehpur Sikri. This picture is of Fatehpur Sikri. Fatehpur Sikri, by and large, is built by red stone. If you see the Buland Darwaza of Fatehpur Sikri, it is of red stone. And the entire architecture, you will see, there's a dominance of red stone. But there is a marble building here. This is called Moinuddin Chisti's Dargah. Moinuddin Chisti's Dargah. Moinuddin Chisti was the philosopher guide of Emperor Akbar. So he built a dargah for him. I think Moinuddin Chisti was buried here. But this is a marble building. I'm sure it is built by Akbar. But the other building, please take note of this. The other building, at least the major part of the other building, was not built by Akbar. If you observe closely, you will see that this main entrance is an imposition upon the rest of the building. Why is it an imposition? Because there is a dome behind this and it is not visible. The dome is larger than the other domes, but there is a gateway which is there, which obscures the main dome. I mean, nobody who is sensitive to aesthetics would build this kind of entrance. Take note that the entrance is disproportionately large. Take note that it covers the main dome. I guess it was built by Akbar. Why do I say it is, why am I so certain about that? I believe that this inverted lotus symbol must have been existing earlier. And you cover the main dome with this. See, it is like saying that you wash your face, put talcum powder, put lipstick, apply kajal on your eyes, wear silk shirts, and then put on a burqa and then go. It is like this. Who would obscure the main dome? look at the Taj Mahal, the beauty comes from the main dome. The major contributor to its grace comes from the main dome. And see where the gateway is built. Gateway is built half a kilometer away. So that from the gateway as you enter, it is an enthralling sight. I believe that this gateway, as well as this Moinuddin Chisti's thing, it just doesn't gel. The entire thing is a red stone and then there is a marble thing. It looks gaudy and it looks ugly. You see, the gateway is drawing support from the main dome. You see the bricks here? So it is not an integral part. The gateway is not an integral part of the original structure. This is Akbar's architecture. But notice that there are no minarets here. No minarets. This is Humayun's tomb. We have seen that it is in the center of a garden. The Mughal garden was a style taken from Taj Mahal. Earlier to Mughal Taj Mahal, the gardens and the tomb or the main building is in the center of a garden. That is Akbar's style. This is Humayun's tomb in Delhi, but no minarets. It is not a mosque. So is the Taj Mahal. Taj Mahal also is a tomb. So there is no functional need for a minarets here, nor in the Taj Mahal. See, this dome of the Humayun's tomb is said to have been borrowed from Samarkand. But there is no inverted lotus symbol here. There is no inverted lotus symbol here. There are no trident here. The shape is not bulbous. It is different. You can say it is Samarkand architecture if you want. But it is not modeled after Taj Mahal, nor the Taj Mahal is modeled after this door. Look at Sikand. Okay, this is Humayun's tomb only. Look at Sikandara. Sikandara is in Agra, built by Akbar as his own tomb. Here also you would notice that the gateway is distinct from the rest of the building. It doesn't gel properly. Neither the gateway gels nor the top floor gels. Architecturally, aesthetically, both these things are not gelling with the original structure, I believe. But the important point to note here is that there are no minarets here. But yeah, the Taj Mahal has minarets. So it is not derived from functional utility for sure, nor from the style of the mosques, which is seen as part in the rest of the world. This is the Taj Mosque on the western side of the Taj Mahal. See, this is what I was saying, that there are areas where it is not filled by anything. It is blank. It is blank. Either it is filled in the main building, this portion is filled by calligraphy. Here it is not. My guess is that there was something else here inside upon this wall, but then that has been removed because it's un-Islamic, but the new Islamic thing, calligraphy, has not been imposed here. It is a plain marble. If you see the purpose of these minarets, you just imagine these minarets are not there, the Taj will not look that beautiful. These minarets are ornamental minarets meant for defining a boundary upon the skyline. It is a frame of reference to the building. It is like you're putting a photograph on the wall. To make the photograph come alive, you would put a frame for that. Put a frame. So the Taj Mahal comes alive upon the skyline with this frame. See how beautifully it defines the frame. So they are ornamental minarets, decorative minarets, not taller than the main dome, not of functional utility, not Islamic in origin. This is the southern gateway of Sikandara in Agra. You notice that there is a gateway, yes. You also notice that there are four minarets here, like the four minarets of Taj Mahal. But in the Taj Mahal, the minarets define a frame of reference to the main structure. What do these minarets define? Nothing at all. Nothing at all. Notice that these minarets are not part of the integrated architecture of this gateway itself. Gateway itself is of red stone. Minarets are of white stone, marble. And even historians, even secular historians, like Satish Grover. Satish Grover is considered a very important historian. Look at what he says about these minarets. The location of the minarets over the parapets flanking the main entrance is, to say the least, unusual and a clear case of fortuitous addition rather than comprehensive design. Why is it not part of comprehensive design? Because it doesn't have foundation. Why it is fortuitous addition? Because it is of marble, whereas the rest of the building is not. It is a fortuitous addition. What does it signify? Nothing. What does it give a frame of reference? Nothing. So Satish Grover himself says this. I'm quoting him. The location of the minarets over the parapets flanking the main entrance is, to say the least, unusual and a clear case of fortuitous addition rather than comprehensive design. Then he adds, these minarets were certainly built either as experiments before erecting those of the Taj or immediately thereafter. More probably the latter. He doesn't give reasons why they are later, but more probably the latter. He says that they are built after the Taj has been built. If after the Taj has been built, you would build this kind of minarets is unlikely. If somebody who has built the Taj, if he builds it again, it is very unlikely that he would build this kind of minarets. That's what I wanted to say. But it appears not as part of the original design, is very obvious, and it doesn't give a frame of reference to anything. It doesn't have foundation, and it is on the gateway, not upon the main building. Why would anybody build this kind of minarets then? What is the purpose? So they are experiments, he says, maybe earlier, maybe later, more probably after the Taj has been acquired. This is what he says. But Satish Grover says Taj Mahal is Shah Jahan's architecture. Now see this. This is Jama Masjid of Delhi. This is attributed to Shah Jahan. And perhaps it is. It is. But it was built in 1658. See, 1640, Taj Mahal was whatever construction is over. 12 years, he says. So 1641, 42, it must have been over. Now 1658, several years later, more than a decade later, if Shah Jahan himself builds a building with the domes, with minarets, this is how he builds. Do you think it was Shah Jahan who built the Taj Mahal? Look at the minarets. Look at the front gateway, which obscures the main dome. Is this a style which the Taj depicts? It entirely comes alive in the Taj, not here. It's a triple dome structure with inverted lotus. The main gateway appears to be disproportionately large, covering the main dome. And the minarets of greatly inferior quality compared to that of the Taj. If Shah Jahan has built this 15 years after the Taj Mahal, I would only say Shah Jahan did not build Taj Mahal. This is the son, Aurangzeb. Aurangzeb built Biwi ki Makbara at Aurangabad. It is the tomb of Rabia Durrani, the wife of Aurangzeb, who died in Aurangabad. So he built a tomb there. And it is modeled after the Taj Mahal. But historians, architects are unanimous in saying that it is a very bad copy of the Taj Mahal. The conception, the grandness of conception is just not there. But it is built by Aurangzeb. You can look at the minarets, the style of the minarets, etc. So the minaret of the Taj Mahal does not belong to the category of Islamic minarets. They are ornamental minarets, not the functional minarets of traditional mosques. The minarets of Islamic architecture were not an essential part of the first 440 years of Islamic architecture in India. I would say it was not part of Babur's architecture, it was not part of Akbar's architecture. It became Aurangzeb's it became part of Shahjahan's architecture after he commandeered Raja Mansingh's palace. After the initial fiasco at Ajmer in 1192, the minarets are not part of Pathan architecture at all, nor part of the Mughal architecture, until the time Shahjahan acquired Raja Mansingh's palace. The Taj was the first of its kind, which became the trendsetter for the subsequent Mughal architecture. Yeah, Aurangzeb copied it. Shahjahan himself copied it in Delhi. And the minarets became part of Mughal architecture. Not only minarets, even the Mughal garden became Mughal garden only after the Taj Mahal showed that. So Mughal garden was not the part of Humayun's tomb in Delhi. Yeah, so here I stop. If there are any comments on this part of the presentation, I would like to hear. Thank you so much. Any comments, please?
Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah.
This is MS Pat.
Yeah.
So very wonderful, analysis of various tombs and mosques in India. My question is, when did they are? What would be the reason to have three tombs? In a couple of places we see three tombs.
Yeah, see, in Indian architecture, three domes is very normal. Trinity is a symbol in India. Whether it is Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwar, or Lakshmi, Ganesh, Saraswati, Trinity is an important symbol in India. In India, you will find meaning for every number that way. One is there, two is there, three is there, eight is there, 11 is there. So every number finds an architectural symbol and meaning in India because it is a very rich tradition. So many places, it is not that others cannot copy this, but if it is a copy, it's a copy. It is not original. Trinity is not seen in the architecture, Islamic architecture outside India. It is not seen. Just like we say that the minaret which is in the Taj Mahal is not seen outside. It is entirely a decorative symbol. It gives a frame of reference. It is an artistic exuberance that has given rise to this kind of creativity. It is not functional utility. It is not Islamic in nature. Of course, we have not discussed the domes yet. We have discussed only the minarets. And to me, it is clear that first 400, see, it is not an indispensable part even in Islamic architecture. First 440 years, they did not use minarets at all. They tried in Ajmer, which fell off. And if you ask E.B. Havel, he will say that it is because these invading barbarians, they interfered with the construction workers. They did not accept the advice. It must have fallen off. Otherwise, somebody would certainly say that you need a foundation for a minaret. You can't build it on the shoulder of a screen.
Right.
Yeah. This is E.B. Havel's opinion, not mine. Mm-hmm. Havel wrote his book, Indian Architecture, in 1913. Interestingly, Havel doesn't question the premise that Shah Jahan built Taj Mahal. He doesn't question that. He thinks that it is Shah Jahan who built it. Or under Shah Jahan it was built. But he says the architectural style, the features, symbolism, all these things belong to India, not to Islam. That was his thesis. You cannot say, okay, the dome, Taj dome is entirely India. He quotes chapter and verse of Hindu Shilpa Shastras to say which part is what. The base, the griva, the kalasha, the pattika, all these terms he quotes from the Hindu Shilpa Shastras and says, this is described in the Hindu Shilpa Shastras. There is a power failure here.
Okay.
Just wait for a minute. Yeah.
So is the hypothesis that all domes with inverted lotuses were pre-Islamic? I mean, I'm not understanding. Because my question comes from the fact that actually two points. One is even Purana Kila in Delhi has inverted domes in those buildings, which I think are much older, probably even before Mughals.
Yeah.
And second thing is, like you mentioned, Jama Masjid in Delhi, maybe Shah Jahan built it. That yeah. also has inverted domes, right? So yeah. why would Shah Jahan take something that is not Islamic then?
I do not know why he would take. I am not saying he did build it. I am saying he may have built it. But whatever it is, he may have built it or something. Even if I accept that he may have built it, I see that the quality of that architecture is not comparable to that of Taj Mahal. Inverted lotus. See, this is the first Mughal architecture which shows. This is the first Mughal architecture. First Islamic architecture which shows inverted.
I would disagree. This is not first, right, Babri? Because like I told you, Purana Kila, I mean, yeah, even that would come before Babur, right?
Purana Kila may have come before Babur, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But yeah. that doesn't undo my point. This could have been, the domes could have been the part of an earlier structure which might have been retained. I am not saying, see, it needs a much more careful study than studying the books. It requires a deeper study, looking at the architecture and other evidences with an unbiased mind. When I say that, okay, inverted lotus is an Indian symbol, I'm only saying that much. It is a symbol not belonging to Arabia or Persia because there was no water. How can the lotus be a part of that symbol? It is possible that having come to India, people might have adopted part of that because the craftsmen are accomplished in that. So it looked beautiful to somebody and say that, okay, let us, instead of a bald dome, let us have an inverted. It is possible.
Right.
I am only saying that it is a symbol which belongs to India. So you have to be very careful in analyzing and accepting the conclusion that the moment you see a dome, it is Islamic. It may not be. It may not be.
Yeah, I think we agree on that. That lotus is inverted. Lotus is certainly Indian. I mean, we can look at several domes outside India, and we will not see inverted lotus. But my only this thing is that simply because it's a inverted lotus doesn't mean that it may not have been built by Islamic rulers. Is what the point?
Anand, why are you drawing, putting words into my mouth which I am not, did not mean?
Okay, I just wanted to confirm that's not what you are meaning, right? Because yes, it was kind of.
See, the these talk, extreme conclusions from a small symbol is not proper. It requires a much deeper study. For example, the picture that I am showing now. See, this gateway is an imposition on the rest of the architecture. That is for sure. That is for sure. See, you need to say, now if you say that the whole thing is built by Akbar, I would question that. Mm-hmm. I would say, on what basis are you saying that? See, this city was not in the hands of any ruler after Akbar left it. So who put this structure? Obviously, it was Akbar. It is called Fatehpur Sikri. It belonged to the Sikarwar Rajputs. There is a clan of Rajputs known as Sikarwars. And Akbar conquered it. Then he must have built something on that. After all, it has become his property, his capital. He would have built something. But if you see that what is built now in front of this dome, I would say this is a superimposition. If you say this is superimposition, I would say it is not part of the original integral design. It is very obvious to me because the main dome is covered. And I see pictures which, you see, there is a support taken from the main dome and you build such a beautiful dome there and then cover it up. Somebody who is he feels himself to be so important that he wants to build a gateway which is covering the main dome and says that this is my architecture. Yeah, only the gateway.
Now it you may only. I don't have any comments on this one. I just wanted to make a point that I was not trying to put words in your mouth. I was trying to confirm that. Simply because it's a lotus, you are not saying that it may not be Islamic, right? So I think you clarified that yes, that's not the position you are taking.
I don't say about that on any single point. It should be an integrated study.
Mm-hmm.
And there is enough reason to make a systematic study based on the scientific evidence also. When I say scientific evidence, I am saying that thermoluminescence test and carbon dating should be part of the integrated study.
Mm-hmm.
It is not just a child's play that I can come and say this or that and you say, see, I have drawn my conclusions based on a very superficial study of books, evidences that are available. I am not an architect. I didn't go and do the architecture. I did not participate in the excavations. So I cannot make those conclusions. But I am presenting a case where it should be done. It is not the work of one or two individuals to write the history of India. It is the work of a government to take initiative so that a right history is written and given to our children.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's the point I am making. When such anomalies are presented, you just dismiss it. You say that Hindus, it is integrating genius. I question that synthesizing genius of Shah Jahan. Shah Jahan, 26 temples were destroyed in the district of Banaras alone, says Badshanam. And you say that he was a synthesizing genius and other things and wash off everything, which I say. That is not acceptable. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, that I think there is no disagreement that he was not. He did break temples. That I agree. It's just that my point was some elements from Hindu architecture may have been imbibed into Islamic, not just from Shah Jahan, but much earlier also.
Very much possible because in Arabia or Persia or Afghanistan. These architectural styles were not mature.
Yeah.
See, it is in India you see Islamic architecture in its full glory. what you call as Islamic architecture. It is not because there were great architectural science or technology and studies in Baghdad or Persia. It has become great only because it took Indian features. Say they took Indian land, why not the buildings?
Yeah. But
they took Indian women, they took Indian population. So the fact that they have taken Islamic architecture, what you call as the Mughal architecture, has taken from India, there is no doubt. Even Aurangzeb built a Bibi Ki Maqbara, which is very similar to Taj Mahal, or attempted to be similar. He did not succeed in creating another Taj Mahal in the south. It is very inferior. See, these architectural sciences, anybody who has built a house for himself knows how difficult it is. It is not enough if the owner says, I want a beautiful house. It is not enough. It is not enough if he says that I give you money, capital. It requires a live tradition. When I say a live tradition, there should be thousands of people who understand what the chief architect is saying. And the kind of symphony that you see in Taj Mahal, to implement that, it requires a devotion of an unprecedented kind. It is not slave labor which will do that. If you look at the temples in Beluru and Halebidu in Karnataka, they were built over hundreds of years. You see the exquisite beauty and carvings and other things that come out of that work, that devotion. It is a work of generations dedicated totally for the art. And the society should be comfortable during that time. They should have enough to eat. The king should be able to support them. He says, you do this exclusively for 20 years, 30 years. Not a society which is torn by war. And the last 1,000 years of Indian history is not a great period. Not a great period either for the invaders nor for the Indians. It was a time of strife. You see, the entire North India, the great works of architecture are only Islamic. How is that? And you think that kind of a strife would enable people to work, even if they are taken as slaves?
Correct. So a couple of points I just want to, this is just for information purpose. You kind of seem to imply that Islamic architecture is Baghdad and it comes from that.
Yeah.
I feel, after traveling to Middle East quite a bit, not quite a bit, whatever I have is, see, Islamic architecture that we say, it's different at different places. Like if you go to Spain, their arches are not single pointed arch. Their arches look more Christian. Which is just that round Gothic type, not Gothic, the roundish. I hope you understand what I mean. But it will be an Islamic mosque, for example. So Muslims, wherever they went, they basically, that's what I think, based on my reading and also traveling to these places, they basically adopted the local architecture. They might have put something like a mihrab or a qibla or something. But local architecture was taken by Muslims. So when they came to India, they probably adopted some of the Hindu elements into their these things. So saying that it has to be a single pointed arch, only then it is Islamic, is also maybe questionable, because we can find arches outside India which are not single pointed, but which are Islamic, I guess. So I think it depends on the region,
I agree with you. I am only saying that this argument that it is single-pointed arch, therefore Islamic, is not a correct conclusion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I am saying only that.
Yeah.
Single-pointed arch were there. You have studied Havel.
Yeah.
Havel gives a chapter and verse on that. and he says how it evolved. He says Ajanta and Ellora, they're single pointed arches. Ajanta, yeah. Ellora is the 1,000 years, 1,500 years before Shatan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. Just a general question. Second point is, we keep saying that domes may not be Islamic, may not have been brought to India by Muslims. Let's say it's, I don't think we should call it Islamic, because they really come from before Islam, from Eastern Roman Empire, that kind of thing. But let's say we say that the Muslims bought the big domes to India. And let's say somebody disagrees with it, like you are saying that not necessarily true. In that case, are there examples of big domes in India from before? Do you know of any?
We can discuss these domes in our next session, because that it will set the whole thing in perspective.
Okay.
And yeah, there could be big domes, but then looking at the North India, you cannot cite Indian architecture there today.
Well, there is Khajuraho, and I mean, there are a few in the jungles.
One or two. One or two.
Yeah.
There are domes for certain, but then the domes are may not be exactly like this or that. That may not be the case. But domes are part of Indian architecture. There is no doubt about that. So if you say that, okay, show me another Taj Mahal, I cannot show you another Taj Mahal, because there is only one of that.
Well, I meant the dome, not the Taj Mahal, but big dome.
Yeah, but this
I mean, like Bijapur, somebody raised the point, right? Even Bijapur. And at least I have not seen, I mean, I have not come across any of the Hindu
architecture. That is fine. You can entertain that viewpoint. I have no objection on that. And nor am I trying to evangelize. I am only saying that it needs a much deeper study than what we have done so far.
Right.
And then only you can conclude. A blanket statement that the domes have come from the Islamic architecture is not correct. Because there are documentary references to them in the Shastras.
Mm-hmm.
He said, show me the Shastra of Islamic architecture coming from Persia. Show me the Shastra. Whereas in India, there are Shastras. So I cannot accept that, okay, it has come from outside. That statement, I cannot accept at face value. Whereas I would still say, yes, there are several features that might have been adopted from India into what can be genuinely called Islamic constructions. They would have. In fact, India was known for the artisans. You have read Taimur Lungs, where he says that I have taken 5,000 people from India to Samarkand to build a masjid, a jami in Samarkand. Ghazni has taken thousands of people to work as slave labor. Naturally, see, the craftsmen will take their study, their vidya also along with them, right? So it is not that India received from outside, but India has contributed to outside the country.
Yeah. I think there is no disagreement. My only point is that the scale of the domes that we see, I have not seen those in any Hindu architecture. And the other point I want to make is, we see these domes in Dome of Rock or Eastern Roman Empire. I really don't want to give credit to Islam, because Islam came much later. But the domes have been there even before Islam in Eastern Roman Empire. So the scale of these domes came from there. And it was brought to India by Muslims, at least the maybe the way you build these big domes, for example. So the dome as such might have been there in India, Indian architecture, but from what I've seen, they are all small, like Ajanta, Ellora, even the Prambanam. I've not been to Prambanam, but I've seen the pictures and those kind of things. So my only point is that the scale of that and building these big ones probably were brought to India by Muslims.
I don't agree with it fully, but then you can entertain your opinion. I have an objection to that.
Sure.
Yeah, any other comments, sir? Shall we close then?
Yes, sir. Let's close this session. Thank you very much, sir. And thanks everyone for the active participation. Let's close with the Shanti Mantra.
Okay.
Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha Sarve Santu Niramaya Sarve Bhadrani Paschantu Ma Kaschid Dukkha Bhag Bhavet Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Thank you, sir.